We're going to go ahead and get started. We're working out all of the technical issues on the back end. I hope everyone's doing well. Welcome. On Friday, August 26th of this year, Professors Anthea Butler, who's a religious studies and Africana studies professor at UPenn, and Professor Kevin Gannon, a historian from Grand Valley University, put out the call on Twitter for hashtag scholar strike in response to unrelenting anti-Black police violence with the recent shooting of Jacob Blake. This week, we celebrated the tumultuous legacies of labor activism, and scholar strike is situated within this legacy.
Across the United States, organizations such as the National Education Policy Center, the American Sociological Association, and the American Anthropological Association have supported this movement. While hashtag scholar strike is a movement outside of Arizona State University, the teach-in is a collaborative effort to offer context and socio-historical framing for students and the broader ASU community to deepen our understanding of the moment. We also would like to recognize ASU's Barrett, the Honors College, for organizing a two-day teach-in for racial justice.
President Michael Crow has committed to 25 courses of action to deepen our commitment as an institution to our charter, whereby ASU assumes fundamental responsibility for the economic, social, cultural, and overall health of the communities that it serves. Today's teach-in is a recognition of the many academic schools, scholars, and student leaders that have engaged in social justice work on all of our campuses and communities for a long time. As the university increases its social justice investments, our community is here to work alongside campus administrators and to elevate the voices of our critical constituents.
Welcome, everyone. My name is Dr. Vanessa Fonseca Chavez. I'm an assistant professor of English in the College of Integrative Sciences and Arts and the president of the Faculty Women of Color Caucus.
And I'm Dr. Mako Fitz Ward. I'm a clinical assistant professor and faculty head of African and African American Studies in the School of Social Transformation.
We thank you all for joining us today and want to offer just a few notes on the process as we begin our teach-in. We thank you all for participating and invite you to submit questions via the chat function. We encourage you to attend the interactive session immediately following this webinar from 2 to 3 o'clock by using Zoom ID ASU Teach-In 2020. Questions posed during this webinar will be compiled and addressed by faculty facilitators at that time.
We begin with a grounding ritual and acknowledgement of the land in which we're on, by welcoming Dr. Matthew Sandoval from the Barrett Honors College.
Welcome, everybody. Thank you. I want to begin by acknowledging the land that we're on and also leading us through a quick exercise really to ground us for the conversation today. If you are at ASU, then it's important that you acknowledge that you are on Pipash and Akamel Otham territory. If you are somewhere else other than ASU, I encourage you to find what Indigenous territory you reside on. I'm coming to you live from Los Angeles today, a colonial city founded in 1781 by Black Mexicans. I want to say that again, by Black Mexicans, Afro-Latinos. It's a colonial city, and it's a city that began as Tongva territory. So I'm acknowledging the land that I'm on. I want to lead us through a very quick exercise before we get going. And I know that we are all differently abled, so everybody do what you can here to the best of your abilities. I want you to place your feet firmly on the ground. Trying to ground us here. I want you to place your feet wherever you are at. If you are standing, if you are at a desk, I want you to plant your feet firmly on the ground. And I just want you to check in with your breath before we get going. Just check in with that life force, that force that's giving you life, your breath. I want you to feel rooted and I want you to feel your life force. And I want you to imagine And I want you to feel, as you imagine, yourself growing roots through your feet into the earth. I want you to feel planted. I use that word strategically, intentionally. I want you to feel planted today. Planting is what we're doing for the next couple hours together. We are planting. We are planting ideas. We are planting wisdom, knowledge, provocation, agitation, education, organization. We are planting spirit. Folks, today we are planting. We know that what we plant today is going to bear fruit tomorrow or in the coming days or in the coming weeks. What we plant will grow upwards, outwards, towards heaven, towards a promised land, towards justice, towards liberation. I need you to feel planted today, folks. Really feel planted. We know that while we grow from our planting, that we don't just grow individually, we grow as a community, can only ever grow as a community. What we plant today will grow as collective uplift. Folks, I want you to feel planted today. I want you to feel roots growing into this earth that you occupy for this split second moment that you get to call life. Folks, today we are planting. Folks, today we are planted. Folks, today we are planted planetary people full of life, but dead set on changing this world. Thank you for joining us and stay planted today. Thank you so much, everybody.
Thank you so much, Matthew, for providing the context for our grounding today. Just a quick note that chat has been disabled and you can pose your questions through the Q&A function within the webinar. So again, thank you, Matthew, for that. Our next presenter is Dr. Ursula J. Orr, Lincoln Professor of Ethics and Associate Professor of African and African-American Studies in the School of Social Transformation.
Hello. My name is Dr. Ursula Orr, Associate Professor of African and African American Studies here at ASU, and I'd like to quickly highlight a point about racism and continuity. Equality and dignity, basic human rights such as the right to life without torture, life without terror, life without slavery, and the basic right to life, civil rights like the right to liberty, the right to vote, the public right to education, and the public right to literacy, the right to access and use of public facilities and government services are all basic human and civil rights that Blacks have categorically struggled to acquire since slavery and that Blacks continue to struggle for today. We fought for these struggles in the courts of public opinion and courts of law in demand of our dignity and humanity with the purpose of illuminating the inherent contradictions between America's principles and its governing practices. It was upon these contradictions that investigative journalist, founding member of the NAACP, Ida B. Wells, highlighted the race and gender dynamics of lynching as a pernicious form of racial terror that weaponized myths of white innocence and Black guilt to maintain a system of social control following abolition. Wells made this point over 100 years ago, and yet today's post-racial society, it still holds. We see its persistence in the murders of Amadou Diallo, Mike Bell, Jordan Davis, Tamir Rice, Trayvon Martin, Eric Gardner, Mike Brown, Philando Castile, Sandra Bland, Freddie Gray, Ahmaud Arbery, Breonna Taylor, George Floyd, Deion Johnson, and Jacob Blake, among others. So many others. Letetra Wideman, Jacob Blake's sister, made the same claim 2 weeks ago when she read The Legacy of Lynching as part of her inheritance, saying that this has been happening to my family for so long, for a long, long time. It happened to Emmett Till. Emmett Till is my family. Philando, Mike Brown, Sandra Bland, they are all my family, she said. As I explain in my book, Lynching, Violence, Rhetoric, and American Identity, Till is a chief symbol of democratic declension, of America's willful refusal to make good on its promises and protections of democracy for Blacks. Trayvon Martin is a 21st century iteration of Emmett Till, and this troubling repetition and others like it point to racism's permanence despite America's grand narratives of progress and change and constant assertions of an America beyond race. To read Emmett Till and Jacob Blake along the same continuum of anti-Black terror as Letitia Weidman does is both a pedagogical act and evidence of a critical democratic literacy specific to assisting Black folks negotiate the ways America, to echo Kesey Lehman, is set up to kill us. This is all to say that whether a noose, a knee, or a disease weaponized by structural forces, America's campaign of anti-Black terrorism continues to leave Black folks fighting to breathe, struggling for breath. Only in a country built on Black disposability can jogging while Black be a crime. Do officers mercilessly need necks for the camera, and the most vulnerable deemed essential but not essential enough to protect? Only in America can 26 weeks pass without justice for Breonna Taylor. If there's anything you take away from this teaching, is that breathing in times of suffocating anti-Blackness demands recognition that the degree of difference between Breonna Taylor, Ahmaud Arbery, George Floyd, Jacob Blake, and the 20,000 Black victims of COVID-19 is marginal. It is a difference of form, not motive, on account that anti-Blackness is a multi-million dollar industry that coordinates healthcare systems, education, the economy, labor, the criminal punishment system, private industry, housing, and surveillance technologies to profit off of the containment and subsequent commodification of Black lives. The most vulnerable are ultimately turned into property and profit. Justice for Ahmaud Arbery, then, just like justice for Breonna Taylor and George Floyd and Jacob Blake and so many others, is part of a larger ongoing struggle against a pervasive American tradition that must be named, rendered visible, and dismantled. The School of Social Transformation is here to do that work.
Thank you, Dr. Orr. Up next, we have Dr. Alexander Avina and Dr. Catherine Bynum from the School of Historical, Philosophical, and Religious Studies.
Good afternoon. My name is Dr. Catherine Bynum. I am an assistant professor of history in the School of Historical, Philosophical, and Religious Studies. I research the history of grassroots organizing against police brutality in both the Black and Brown freedom struggles.
So we may be having some technical issues with Dr. Avina's audio, but we're working it out.
I can go ahead and get started. I'll read through the questions, or I'll read through my statement. So 57 years ago, on August 28, 1963, a crowd of some 200,000 people descended upon the steps of the Lincoln Memorial in Washington, D.C. Organized by a multiracial coalition of labor rights and civil rights activists, the March on Washington for Jobs and Freedom invited the nation to abide by its founding principles of liberty and democracy for all. Speakers such as Bayard Rustin, Roy Wilkins, and the Reverend Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. addressed the racial inequities in education, housing, employment, and other racial barriers that kept Black people in a permanent state of second-class citizenship. In his famous I Have a Dream speech, Dr. King encapsulated the audience and generations to come with his calls for unity, nonviolence, and the principles of democracy and freedom. He spoke with true resonance and in firm belief that the United States would fulfill its duties to become a place in which all men are created equal. Regardless of circumstances, he dreamed, a person would be judged based on the content of their character and not by the color of their skin. Recognized as one of the most prolific speeches in our nation's history, Dr. King's speech has become an iconic symbol of the goals and legacies of the African-American civil rights movement in the United States. What many have forgotten or chosen to ignore, however, was Dr. King's assertion that police violence prevented Black people from reaching freedom. Just as he condemned segregated spaces for white and Black Americans and denounced widespread voter disenfranchisement in his speech, Dr. King also decried law enforcement's routine abuses against Black women and men. There are those who are asking the devotees of civil rights, when will you be satisfied? We can never be satisfied as long as the Negro is the victim of the unspeakable horrors of police brutality, he stated. Freedom, he reasoned, not only meant access and opportunity, it also meant the absence of state-sanctioned violence.
So I apologize for the technical difficulties. So our idea is to have a conversation based on Dr. Bynum's expertise on the history of police brutality and violence in the United States and its connection to Black freedom struggle. So our idea is just to have this brief conversation. Dr. Bynum, in what ways does your research on police violence and the Black freedom struggle build on that really powerful assertion made by Dr. King in that, quote, police violence prevented Black people from reaching freedom?
I found that the movement, the civil rights movement, actually centered on ending police violence. It was a central goal of this broader movement in the 20th century. And it's been a goal, it was a goal that's been erased from our modern understanding of the movement. When we think of the civil rights movement, we often think of ending segregation or acquiring voting rights, but we never associate state violence as a source of control that upheld white supremacy. So my scholarship draws out how racist policing and police brutality were deeply intertwined to so many other issues, whether it be discrimination in housing, the entire criminal justice system, voting, poverty, and social welfare policies, just to name a few. The powers that be, so to speak, relied on law enforcement to control these various aspects of our lives.
So we as historians, at least you and I as historians, I think believe that the one insurgent possibility with history is that when we research the past and we research things like police history, if something has a history, it can therefore be radically changed. So what can we learn from the histories of Black resistance to police violence and brutality that can possibly help us today?
Yeah, resistance comes in many different forms and iterations, and many are drawing parallels between the ongoing rebellions and protests now to the long hot summers of the 1960s. So while there are similarities between the two, all of which have been sparked by police violence, we shouldn't necessarily look at these rebellions in isolation. So either the rebellions in the 1960s or the ones happening now. So over the last century, there have been numerous techniques and acts of resistance that have led us to these moments that we're experiencing today. And it's also important to understand that some of these reforms that are being called upon now, increasing diversity on police forces, more police training, including cultural sensitivity training, creation of police review boards, These were all reforms that were put in place by community organizers as a way to end police violence against communities of color. And many of these reforms happened because Black organizers formed coalitions with other marginalized communities and with white liberal white Americans as well. So Black and Brown communities often marched together in protest. They disrupted city council meetings. They held meetings with chiefs of police. They ran for public office in an effort to see a lot of these reforms implemented. And many of them were wholly committed to using the existing governmental structures to end police violence. But what we also need to remember is that these reforms have not altered policing practices in the US. In many communities across the nation where these reforms have been implemented in various measures and degrees, they have yet to really show any curtailment in racist policing practices. So even modern technologies like dash cams or body cams haven't altered the way that law enforcement interacts with people of color. And video evidence has yet to end this sort of cycle of abuse. And again, if you look at police violence in isolation and don't take into account that it is a symptom that is one symptom that is upheld by a much broader and bigger disease, then reforms are not going to work.
And then finally, going from the negative to the positive, how would you define the freedom that, that Dr. King powerfully mentions, or what Robin Kelly also refers to as freedom dreams? Like, how do you define this freedom?
So oftentimes when we think of the freedom struggles, I think we think of gaining something that we didn't have before, the freedom to vote, the freedom to eat at a certain restaurant, the freedom to shop wherever we like, the freedom to work, however you want to frame it that way. And these were basic rights that African Americans and other marginalized communities were not given. The Black freedom struggle in that way meant gaining some of these rights. But for many people, and I think this includes Dr. King, it also meant having the freedom from certain types of abuses, and police violence certainly fits into that definition. We know that Black and Brown people are more likely to be apprehended by police, more likely to be shot and killed by police. Black and Brown people are more likely to be incarcerated than our white counterparts. And these are products of systemic racism and white supremacy. These sorts of things didn't just happen by accident. They were planned.
Thank you.
Thank you so much, Alexander and Catherine. Our next presenters are Dr. Keon McGuire, Associate Professor in the Mary Lou Fulton Teachers College, and Don Demps and Valencia Clement, doctoral students also in the Teachers College.
So we have the privilege, I guess, an opportunity to talk a little bit about how we see anti-Blackness, structural racism and police violence showing up in education. So I'll start with actually whoever would like to go first. How do you all see anti-Blackness showing up in educational spaces?
Okay, I'll go. It shows up in so many ways. When we talk about anti-Blackness, Dumas defines it as disgust and disregard for Blackness. And so we have a long history since before the first quote-unquote public school started of anti-Blackness, not wanting Black people inside of spaces. And then once they were there, after much pushback, having like this sense of invisibility about them, because to see them somehow would be disgusting or would make the civil uncivil. So when we talk about it in these spaces, of course, we're looking at the school-to-prison pipeline, which is this disparate outcomes of students being pushed out, not just students being pushed out, but compared to their white counterparts, their Asian American counterparts, their Latinx counterparts being pushed out at like these disparate rates for similar infractions or whatever. We're looking at them not being represented in the curriculum. We're looking at them not looking at people in front of the class that look like them, that are instructing them. We're looking at their parents not being welcomed at the school, at creating structures that prevent certain parents from even walking on the campus. So it's so many ways that it shows up in education. I'm sure it has so much to add. So, yeah.
Don, I think you touched on some of the really important ways, and I think one of the things that I think is also important is the evaluations. One of the biggest component of education is making sure that your students are like holding on to the information that you're transmitting to them. And so in thinking about all of the evaluations that students are taking from third grade, especially standardized, a lot of these evaluations, we know that they're culturally biased. We know that they don't include the vocabulary or the lived experiences of the diverse Black students who are living in the country and beyond and learning and benefiting from our systems. So in thinking about the ways that we evaluate students, it kind of connects to the ways in which deficit philosophies and mindsets are attached to these collective communities and lead to compounding anti-Blackness. So it's not even just that we're not teaching the students, that we're over-policing the students, that we're over-disciplining the students. It's also that when we evaluate them, we don't have their best intent in mind. And so what do we do to make sure that when we're evaluating them, that it's culturally relevant, that embraces the diverse knowledges that they're picking up in school, but as well as at home, in the media, and in various places where Black students are scavenging for their knowledge and their history.
First of all, y'all are dope. Let's just start there. Appreciate y'all. You know, the only thing I would add, what I think really just aligns with what you're saying is, you know, if we understand anti-Blackness as really a fundamental belief that Black people are not human beings, are fundamentally and forever inferior, then that when it comes up against a anti-Black schooling context and practices and assessments and policing, then the process is always about really a separation of Black people from their cultural, physical, linguistic, spiritual home, right? Which further perpetuates all types of violence on our psyches. And so we know, I believe it's Patricia Williams who talks about spirit murdering, and which Bettina Love takes up in her text as well. And so what does it mean? Or I guess it's not what does it mean, but anti-Black schooling is very much committed to the murdering of our spirits, both of ourselves, of our children. But through those things such as curriculum, through those things such as assessments, through those things such as low expectations, not seeing yourself in who is in front of the classroom or in the physical spaces, and that carries out from P through 20, right? So I think we've all hit on like a bunch of good points in the ways that violence is very much at the core of the U.S. schooling project, an educational project when it comes to non-white, but particularly in this case to Black folks. So a couple of things y'all hit on, I would love to hear y'all say a little bit more about, which is this notion of policing. And I know both of y'all take this up in your work. And what are the ways that you see police violence manifesting in educational spaces?
Yeah, I don't mind going first on this one. I would say that the policing in general, when we think about policing and in general, the history of the institution, these folks in general, like this policing institution was created with racist intentions. And so the criminalization of behaviors that have to do with culture have gone back to slavery, but extending into the Black codes, which led to like the starting of a lot of American schools and universities. And so when we think about the number of police officers, metal detectors, zero tolerance policies, and we compare them to the rate that they are in Black schools, predominantly Black schools, or predominantly free and reduced lunch schools, we notice that the rate of disciplinary infractions and police presence decreased tremendously as a number of Black and brown bodies. And so we're starting to wonder, what is the connection, and why are police being instilled into schools to help students understand how to create the link between crime or bad behaviors and punishment? And we know that this is a problem because schools are not the place to punish students. Schools are places to educate students. So when you place a police presence in a school, you're telling a student that this is the person that's going to be monitoring you from now until the rest of your life. So you start to think about the signaling that you send to students about who is there to protect them versus who is there to punish them. So it creates from a very young age this ideology in a lot of students who are in schools with police that the police are not there to help them. The police are not there to save them. The police are not there to fix their bikes. Rather, the police are there to make sure that if they do anything wrong, that they are being watched, just like the panopticon in the original prisons, and that they will be justly taken to criminal justice or adult detention, internal to school suspension or alternative schooling, taken away from their, isolated from their peers and put in a space that conditions them to exist as prisoners and conditions them to exist as properties of the state, which in and of itself is an act of anti-Blackness and another form of conditioning folks for slavery. So I'll pass it on.
Okay. Pass the mic.
So much. She made me think about so much. David Stovall and other scholars talk about the school-to-prison nexus. And really it's talking about the ways, this is one, you know, part of that is talking about the ways that we have created schools to mimic the prison system, right? To mimic what is happening inside of prisons. When I was back home in Flint, we had this meeting, this community meeting about students who were being suspended because a student who was suspended because they didn't walk on the lines. I think it was a third grade, if I remember correctly, that were laid out in tape in this particular school that the student was in. Right. And so that student was suspended at 8-year-old, my child's age, my baby's age, for not walking on a tape line. So I think that the policing goes beyond just the physical police being there, but it's a police of our mind, a police of our mentality, a police of our thought processes. And we see that in the schools in a myriad of ways with our students of color, where if they come up with something else that is pushing back or questioning the curriculum, right, or questioning the way that things are being done, or reaching back to their ancestral knowledge and saying, yo, have y'all ever considered this? I mean, that happened to me when I was in school and I like pushed up against a history teacher about something he was teaching and he like went off. And so what does that do to us as people? I would also say that this sense of being policed physically and spiritually connects with anti-Blackness in this way that I think a lot of people don't talk about, which is why I think anti-Blackness is different than racism, is that you can be Black and be anti-Black. And I think that the necessity of Black people being anti-Black is different than white people being anti-Black. A lot of people see this as a means of survival. Like the only way we can get through this system is to separate ourselves from anything ancestral, anything indigenous to our people, our language, our hair, all of those things. And so, you have some people who will work hard to separate themselves from that. Like, yo, we can't dress like this. We can't talk like this. So what does that do to the rest of us? And what does that do to us as Black people in general? And that's kind of like the insidiousness of anti-Blackness is it doesn't, anybody can be anti-Black. Again, going back to what Dumas says, it's really about a disgust and disregard for Blackness.
So that said, again, thank y'all so much for participating in this. I appreciate y'all. Word, Val.
Word.
All right, thank y'all. I appreciate being able to learn alongside y'all. Y'all, again, y'all are dope. All right, peace.
Looks like Mako's on mute, so I'll go ahead and take this. Thank you, Keon, Don, and Valencia. Our next presenters are Dr. Maria Rosario Jackson, an institute professor in the Herberger School for Design and the Arts and the School of Community Resources and Development. We'd also like to welcome Dr. Chandra Krudup, Associate Director for Student Services and Programs and Senior Lecturer in the School of Social Work.
Good afternoon, everyone. We first would like to start by thanking the group that has come together for this very important conversation. Today, we will be sharing some thoughts about race, arts, and place in building and keeping healthy communities. Like Vanessa mentioned, my name is Chandra Krudup. I am in the School of Social Work in the Watts College. I'm also a fellow with the Studio for Creative Placemaking and Equitable Communities.
So hello, everyone. I'm Maria Rosario Jackson. I direct the Studio for Creativity, Place, and Equitable Communities And I think what we want to share with you are some of the ideas that undergird the work that happens at the studio. The studio really is about integrating arts, culture, and design into how we think of healthy communities, especially communities where African Americans, Black people, BIPOC, people from historically marginalized communities can thrive. And my own root fields are community development and urban planning. And I'll just start by saying, when I started my own journey in this work about 30 years ago, I had very well-intentioned colleagues who would ask me, why are you doing this arts and culture stuff? You care about race, you care about inequity. Why aren't you doing housing? Or why aren't you doing something on environment or something that was more legibly related to urban planning? And I stuck with it. And the reason I stuck with it was a gut feeling that part of our challenge is that in community development and planning, we haven't reckoned with the dehumanizing ways in which violence has been done to us culturally. And I knew it personally, growing up African-American and Mexican, constant was the narrative that was about degradation, that was about erasure, that was about shame, that was about so many of the things that the previous colleagues talked about. And I knew that embracing culture, embracing identity was critical to our survival and critical to any kind of thriving. And once I got out of my own story and I start looking around the world and throughout the ages, you see that in strategies to disempower, the first thing that people do is to mess with your ability to make meaning, to have aesthetics, to make sense of the world, to tell your own story on your own terms. So the premise for the work that I've been doing and most recently have started doing at ASU is if we know that art and culture is so important that it has to be controlled or stripped away or diminished in order to subjugate, then why don't we think of it as central to how we build ourselves up? And I think the work at the studio very much embraces this notion that a healthy community has to reckon with that kind of harm, and that arts, culture, and design are essential to people who want to express their full humanity, as we deserve to be able to do. So that's one of the ideas. I know I come at the work from an urban planning and community development perspective. Chandra comes at it from a social work perspective and is, I think, is developing some really important ideas related to this notion of when place, race, power, and community converge, what does that mean? Chandra.
So to jump off some of what Maria's talking about in the healthy community, I've been able to experience this in the last 20 plus years. It's interesting to think about the creative state of Black and BIPOC communities and the importance of recognizing the opportunity of action in this moment. And I'm reminded that we are not starting from scratch, as was discussed in one of the previous sessions. This isn't necessarily a new notion. It hasn't always been successful. It has been tabled for a number of ways. But here in the Phoenix Valley, there is an example of an arts organization and a place that was birthed out of a similar time. The Black Theater Troupe was founded in 1970 in the wake of protests that swept the nation in the late 60s. Helen K. Mason was a City of Phoenix worker, and she, with 15 students, began performing in a rec center. They needed to have a place to have some rap sessions to deal with all of the racial tension that was happening in the Valley, but around the country as well. This was the beginning of what has turned into an award-winning theater company, sharing Black stories for thousands of people every year. It's one of the longest continuously running Black theaters in the country. The Black theater troupe has become a staple in the community and has become a place to share stories and history that aren't told elsewhere. So this is an example of a community space that is combined with arts to create a healthy space to organize, to laugh, to celebrate, to reflect on the historical trauma of being Black in this country, to have dialogues around systemic racism, and to challenge the community to action. In this way, the theater space and arts has contributed to the growth of a healthy space for community and continues to challenge. So I'm reminded in this moment that there are places that we can go to continue to have these discussions. So we don't have to start from scratch, but what do we do now moving forward to ensure that there isn't a continued perpetuation of the cycle? Looking at the time we have left, we would like to just pose some questions that we are sitting with as we look at this current moment through the lens in which Maria set out today of power and race and place and arts, and challenge everybody viewing this to think about ways that they might be able to continue work they might be doing, to change work that they might be doing, to stop doing something that they might be doing, to move forward in a way that will address the stain of white supremacy. Maria.
Yeah, I'll just put some things out there that I've been working on for a long time and that are increasingly on my mind now. And a lot of it has to do with how we gauge progress. You know, what does it mean to move ahead or move forward? What does it feel like, and what does it look like to move away from white supremacist structures and to be able to adopt new ways of being and doing and existing, if you will. The challenge, I would say, in the community development and planning field is that the metrics that we use don't often account for the repair that has to happen as a result of violence done to spirit. As someone earlier said in this session, we don't always look to track progress in really important things that matter. How is it that we can begin to track whether or not we are reclaiming our identity? Is that something that we can track alongside availability of affordable housing or the existence of job opportunities and similar? These are the kinds of things that planners and community developers think about, but we don't sufficiently think about that repair of harm that I've heard talked about in the session we have today. And I think part of the work that I'm committed to from the various perches where I sit is figuring out how do we reconceive our ability to track progress. When progress doesn't look necessarily like more efficiency or more widgets produced or even a more efficient machine, if you will. Sometimes progress looks a little bit like chaos and needs to feel disorienting because we need to be disoriented away from things that are harmful. So that is some of the questions that I sit with is how do we go about understanding and tracking progress, and how, in the face of ways of measuring success that actually militate against what we aspire to, how do we push a different paradigm?
And a few things that I am thinking about these days, and I know our time is up, so I'll make it quick, is looking at intentionality and equity in that design. What does that look like? How do we address the historical trauma? How do we deconstruct the colonial frameworks in which we currently navigate and reimagine a future for our youth to imagine a place where they might not have to do the heavy lifting that we need to do, we must do? And how do the arts become a necessary tenet in that design moving forward to continue to ground us in healing as well as innovation in reimagining a world void of white supremacy? Thank you.
Thank you, Maria and Chandra. Our next presenters are Dr. Liza Ita, Clinical Associate Professor and Director of Online Programming and Digital Immersion for the School of Social and Behavioral Sciences, and Dr. Amina Simmons, a psychologist with ASU's Counseling Services.
Hello. Hey, Amina. So I can see you. I cannot see me.
I can see you and me. This is fun.
All right. Okay. So I want to welcome everyone to this afternoon part of our webinar, our talk. And from the very beginning, even before we get started, I want to acknowledge what was said right at the beginning about this planting. So all the organizers, our organizers at ASU, as well as, you know, nationally, the intention of this was to build solidarity, build relationships. And I met Amina through this collective action that we're doing right here so that we could start our journey together and our collaborative work. So I just want to give a big shout out to everyone who had part in this day for all of the things and the coalition building that this is inspiring. So with that said, we're going to get right to what we're talking about today, which is mental health in this current era. So Amina, what are you seeing on the day-to-day?
Thank you, Liza, for that, the introduction. So I work as a psychologist at ASU's Counseling Services, and my research background is about the impacts of racial stress and trauma, in particular on Black women's health. And what I'm seeing clinically and interpersonally, if I'm being honest, is this activation of trauma. So like intergenerational, meaning among individuals in family units, and then collective trauma. So like across family units within Black and Brown communities in particular. So I'm gonna give you an example. I had a conversation with my grandma, this amazing, God-fearing Black woman who grew up in the cotton fields of North Carolina, for context. And we're talking around the time that the Breonna Taylor and George Floyd murders was hot news. And we're just talking, you know, we ain't brainstorming no solutions. A lot of ain't nobody surprised, but disappointed again. And quite honestly, I think a little bit of justified fear in there, all in this one conversation. And her voice wavered as she shared her reactions with me. And I have never experienced her so vulnerable. Like, it shook me that this moment shook her, because she'd felt this pain before. My elder was humanized, right, in that moment. And those are the kinds of moments and interactions I'm having with many of my clients, this intense vulnerability and like how we as Black folks are experiencing our humanity right now. And the significance too of this moment hits on something you mentioned when we were chatting the other day, like we acting like this is acute and this is chronic. And that matters because chronic stress has long-term implications for our health.
Yes, it does. And so I'm going to share a little bit about what I'm seeing on the day-to-day, and then I really want to hand it back to you to talk about, you know, your role at ASU, because I want students as well as faculty and staff to know you are there and the good work that you are doing as an expert on Black women, stress, and healing. So from my lens, you know, I'm a faculty, I'm a counseling psychologist. I was also a community health worker, what I call trench trained. You know, I was in people's homes. I was in our public school system. I was in hospitals and our tribal communities throughout Arizona. My current research right now is working with bereaved families from an intersectional lens, focusing on parenting and healing from a family systems perspective. So, you know, what I'm seeing, I actually just did a series of interviews with families from West Philadelphia, which is a historically Black community. And in those interviews, what I was hearing from people, that they're all bereaved families, but of course, during this pandemic, right, we've heard this pandemic of COVID-19, pandemic of racism, pandemic of, you know, economic insecurity. I mean, the list keeps growing and growing. That people in general are dealing with a culture of loss, right? So the families that I work with, they're already bereaved. They're already grieving the death of a loved one, often compounded grief, right? Through, you know, multiple levels of trauma. And right now, then they're also dealing with the loss of their freedom, you know, of, you know, what health looks like, what tomorrow brings. Also, you know, losing economic security, sometimes housing security, sometimes being food insecure. Mm-hmm. So everything that was stabilizing the community is now in question. So when we're dealing with this culture of loss, like another hat that I wear is also, you know, I'm a community birth worker. So, you know, I'm supporting BIPOC families during pregnancy, during birth and postpartum. And we're seeing everything that was already stressful, like even more intense. And so when we're talking about this, you know, culture of loss, loss of safety and security, you know, we also have to talk about the inherent resilience. And so after we talk about what you do at ASU, you know, let's get into that. What are some of the practical strategies about how we can really tap into our community's innate ability to heal?
Yeah, you know, I love that, right? Because I think that the cool thing about my job is that I get to sit with students and especially my Black students, right? Like I get to give them this permission, right? To feel it, whatever it is, right? I know that there are so many other spaces that you occupy that you have to just have it together, right? And what's so fascinating about this is that, you know, women that I interviewed in my dissertation, they said this too. They said, there's a lot of energy that I'm using because something happens in a meeting, but I gotta be mindful because people are watching me, right? If I raise an eyebrow the wrong way, you know, and it's just, there's, I think, so much power in giving them a space to just kind of open up and be there and know that they're not alone in it. And this is really, I think, what's like a great segue into what you're saying about this resilience, because for me, as much as like hearing my grandmother's voice wavered, right? Or when I hear one of my students ask me a question like, how am I supposed to raise my Black child with all of this stuff going on? And I'm like, yeah, that's a good question. Let's sit with that for a second, right? I cannot imagine what you must be experiencing. It's like, let's just acknowledge, right? That's gotta be the first thing that we do. If we don't like we gotta stop pretending this is not happening, right? Especially us as Black people, like this is real in real time. I don't know like what you're seeing. Are you seeing this acknowledgement, right? In the work that you're doing with families?
Well, I'm right there with you, right? Is that so much time we have been socialized to swallow our pain. This is a gendered component. There's an ethno-racial component. Even us, you know, we're in the therapeutic space, but a lot of us grew up where, you know, mental health services, help seeking, that's for crazy people, right? That's if you're weak, don't go out there. Don't, you know, air our dirty laundry. You keep that right here. And that's like the intergenerational transmission of those messages. But as you know, other people mentioning this killing of our spirit, or a Native American psychologist named Eduardo Duran, he talks about the soul wound and how do we heal that soul wound. So that acknowledgement is a very powerful first step, because as you mentioned, people are dealing with, you know, tangible crises, like in the mental health setting, we're dealing with anxiety, depression, you know, a lot of adjustment disordered behavior, people like not knowing, you know, what to make of this current time. But we're also dealing with this existential crisis, right? Worried about the unknown. What is it like to raise children in a world that is inherently discriminatory? So, you know, I want to talk in regards to that resilience. Like, you know, you said something the other day that really struck me, like, you know, like, bring our folks into the room. If you get a group of Black women together, they are going to listen to each other. And I want to, you know, say this really explicitly, that in regards to mental health, culturally responsive care is about giving space and making space and just listening. A lot of times practitioners, they look at race and ethnicity and culture as a risk factor. And in this endemic climate of anti-Blackness, it is absolutely a risk factor, but it's also a protective factor. Mm-hmm. You know, our stories, you know, what we grew up with, everything we have learned has prepared us for this moment. So how as mental health practitioners can we tap into that? So I know you've got some good strategies too.
I mean, like what you're saying is just so spot on, right? Because it's like, I've seen this at other institutions that I've worked with, and it blows my mind how clinicians, sometimes we spend all this time, what am I gonna do? What's the right technique or intervention for my client? Pause, okay, y'all are underestimating. And especially, so I work primarily with college students. We underestimate college students, right? They are bringing so much with them, right? Because remember, they have families, things are written on their DNA, right? That like, we have no idea how we can comprehend that, right? And so when I get them in my office, oftentimes, or if I can get a group of people together, it's like, can we take a moment? Can I ask you to just breathe? And then I want you to check in with yourself. And I want you to say, where am I at? How am I feeling, right? Can you name it? That's power, right? And then ask yourself, so this is where it's like they're doing the work and that becomes empowering, that you can do this for yourself, you can soothe, right? And that you can facilitate this with other people in the room. What do I need in this moment? And what's so powerful about when we create those spaces, especially what I find, right, when I bring Black women together, when I bring women of color together, right, is that sometimes what they need is each other. It's like the emotion starts to overflow because it's like, what I need is to be in this space with y'all right now. And I'm just so grateful, right? It brings me to tears just thinking about it.
Well, I'm just gonna end on that note. Realness, because I wanna just share as a quick closing that we are practitioners, but we are also experiencing this time alongside our clients, our loved ones, our community, and this is the realness that we bring. So thank you, Amina, for sharing so candidly and for being at ASU, being our frontline workers with our students. So thank you to all of the organizers. I know we're at our time. Hopefully we'll be able to have so many more discussions and bring this to the forefront of what we're all dealing with today to support each other.
Thank you, Liza.
Thank you. Thank you, Liza. Thank you, Amina. Thank you for your energy. Thank you for the realness. Thank you for the emotion. It's that time. We're all feeling it. We're all struggling. So thank you for your wisdom and for your honesty. Please don't forget to post questions using the Q&A function. We're going to wrap about these questions during the discussion sessions later on. Our next presenters are Kiara Otis, a gender studies doctoral student, and Danielle Lucero, a justice studies doctoral student, both in the School of Social Transformation. They'll discuss the organizing work, the powerful, important organizing work that they've been doing as part of the Multicultural Solidarity Coalition.
Hello. Like Dr. Ward said, my name is Kiara Otis. I'm a gender studies PhD student, and like Liza Ita, I'm also a birth worker. So that's kind of where my heart lies. And so I'm very moved by that last presentation. So thank you.
Hello, my name is Danielle Lucero. I am from the Pueblo of Isleta, which is located in central New Mexico. I'm a fourth year PhD student in justice and social inquiry. I'm really grateful to be here with you all. We begin by acknowledging the land on which this teach-in is taking place, the traditional homelands of the Akimo Otam and Piposh peoples, the direct descendants of these people who are alive and well, who the Multicultural Solidarity Coalition and our proposal directly address some of their needs. ASU's four campuses are built on and continue to occupy Indigenous lands through colonial tools and is an institution that profits off of anti-Blackness. If this is jarring or news to you, there are resources for you to do that learning, and we encourage you to do so.
So I just want to start off and give some history and context about the work of the Multicultural Solidarity Coalition. So we call it the MSC because it's kind of a mouthful. The MSC is a group of students, staff, faculty, and alumni that have been calling for the return of a multicultural center to ASU's four campuses since 2016. Like most student groups, there have been different iterations of the group, with some folks graduating and new folks arriving. But it's important to know that the MSC has conducted listening sessions and done a lot of research with marginalized students on ASU's campus, which revealed a lack of support services for marginalized students and a lack of feeling safe on campus. So our final proposal came into being this summer with the uprisings, and it's a very comprehensive and intersectional document. It calls for ASU to update their multicultural website, to track and disaggregate race and make this information public. It calls for ASU to hire more underrepresented faculty of color, to implement a community learning fellowship, which was brilliantly thought of by Miriam, and as well as carry out the Cultural Excellence Scholars Program with advisors in each department, as well as implement support programs with staff for marginalized students. And some of the more important points that have been taken up is the need to provide a physical space for marginalized students and to defund and disarm the ASU police and implement a sanctuary campus at ASU. So the full proposal can be found on our social media. We have a link tree where you can find it. Our Instagram handle is MC Solidarity Co. The MSC is not a university-sponsored organization in order to make it more difficult for the university to contain the work that we're doing. ASU administration has not only failed to take the demands of our iteration of a multicultural center seriously, they have prevented and punished other students for working in solidarity with our campaign. I thought it was interesting that this teach-in started with that video with President Crow talking about the new American university, because when he brought this new American university, philosophy to ASU is what prompted him to get rid of the multicultural center. And so when we approached ASU administration about this cultural center, they said the entire campus should be a multicultural center. So this response is very reflective of the race evasive ideology and practices at ASU. So after 4 years, ASU has finally reversed this position. It's expressed its intent to create a multicultural space. And this was just announced last week in President Crow's 25 actions to support Black students, faculty, and staff. So some of the 25 actions are reflective of our proposal. However, other points are the antithesis of our proposal, such as bringing the Department of Homeland Security to campus and rewarding police officers with a bachelor's degree during a global uprising in which people are calling for and actually defunding and disarming police departments. So Danielle will be speaking more to this defunding and disarming part, but please know that we will be talking more about the MSC response to ASU's 25 actions at our upcoming town hall meeting next Friday, September 18th at 6 p.m. And I'll say more about that at the end.
So the Multicultural Solidarity Coalition is participating in this teach-in because we are also calling for the defunding and disarming of the police, specifically at ASU. We are a part of this teach-in to be in solidarity with our fellow scholars striking to protest police violence across the country. This includes ASU working and colluding with local police departments and ICE. Police presence on or near and supported on campus to thrive in their studies, to thrive on our campus. We advocate for the defunding and disarming of the police to protect students, faculty, and staff from all types of police presence. This really speaks to what Val and our other colleagues in the Teachers College had to say about how keeping police in schools is a part of anti-Blackness, because ASU is a school. In the last 8 years, ASU has increased their budgets for police salaries by 56%, skyrocketing from $5.5 million in 2012 to $8.7 million in 2019. These increases have continued despite the fact that Tempe, Phoenix, Scottsdale, Mesa, and Gilbert Police Departments, all of whom ASU PD have working relationships with, continue to disproportionately murder our Black and Latinx community members. According to the state press, the city of Tempe's proposed police budget for 2020-2021 is over $102 million, which makes up 13% of the city's overall $777 million budget. This would make the police department the second most funded city department. The money spent on Tempe police would be three times the amount spent on community services, six times the amount for community development, eight times the amount for human services, 90 times the amount for strategic management and diversity, and 580 times the amount for sustainability. As such, we, the Multicultural Solidarity Coalition, call for the defunding of police, divesting from police, and reinvesting in our community, in us, in the Multicultural Solidarity Coalition, and what we represent and what we bring. A multicultural center is just one step in making ASU campuses a safer place for students, faculty, and staff, where we can find resources and support networks of others who share similar experiences. And at a predominantly white institution like ASU, we are able to feel in community and not alone and isolated. ASU's motto that we define ourselves by who we include and not who we exclude is frivolous when our Black and Brown community members cannot even step on our campuses without fear for their basic safety and lives. When they step on our campuses, are confronted with the police sitting in front of their school building or are walking across to the MU and they have to pass several police officers, or fear of ICE being on campus for recruitment events.
Thank you, Danielle. Said that very beautifully. So I just wanna give y'all a way to get involved with us. So we are on Facebook under the Multicultural Solidarity Coalition. Like I said before, our IG Instagram is at MC Solidarity Co. And we have a link tree where you can contact us and see the full proposal. And we also want people to know that we are encouraging folks to organize where they're at across ASU's four campuses. So on our social media, we posted 10 actions, 10 ways that folks can do that. And we would really love to have individual units, schools, and colleges at ASU sign on to our proposal. I know that there's been some confusion because there's a proposal just for the Multicultural Center, but we need folks to sign on to our entire proposal that calls for the defunding and disarming of the police. You know, with this announcement from Dr. Crow, we're worried about this movement kind of getting co-opted or folks wondering, you know, why, you know, we got what we want. We want police off campus. And so we need your support to do that. So it would be really great to have, you know, any of the schools that have been a part of this conversation that have put on this wonderful teach-in to sign on to our proposal explicitly. And yeah, so in closing, we just encourage all of you to read our proposal, sign on in support, and to mobilize where you're at.
Thank you, Kiara and Danielle, for offering us some perspectives from the Multicultural Solidarity Coalition. Our next presenters are Dr. Marlon M. Bailey, Associate Professor of Women and Gender Studies and African American Studies in the School of Social Transformation, and Dr. Rashad Shabazz, an Associate Professor of African and African American Studies in the School of Social Transformation and the School of Geographical Sciences and Urban Planning.
Good afternoon, everybody. What's up, my brother, Dr. Shabazz? We want to talk about, hey, what's up, man? We want to talk about Black masculinity and space. Dr. Shabazz, I'm glad you're able to have this conversation with me about our work. Both of us, born and raised in the Black Midwest, you in Chicago and me in Detroit, and these experiences have shaped how we see the world and also the knowledges that we produce. And both of us have written in our respective projects and also in our co-authored work, we've written about racial and gender justice as about space and place. So let's talk a little bit about what that means and why is that so important today, given the state and vigilante anti-Black violence that is visited on Black communities and in many ways in spatial terms?
Thank you for the question. My brother, Marlon, is my lifelong brother and best friend, and also an important thinker in the landscape of my work. No movement for social justice is complete without an understanding of its relationship to space and place. So when we talk about movements for racial justice, gender justice, economic justice, for justice of marginalized groups, sexual minorities, we must also understand that all of those forms of justice exist upon a landscape. They exist in an environment and in a place. And what we know about the histories of those communities is that the places that they have lived in have been precarious in so many ways, economically, environmentally, politically, socially, in terms of access to resources. So when we start to talk about racial justice movements, when we start to talk about justice for any underrepresented group, we have to really put space and place as a center point. So the work being done by some of the students around the Multicultural Center is a spatial justice project, right? It is not only a project about racial and economic and ethnic justice, but it is also about how do these groups find a place for themselves on the ASU campus to do the necessary community work to serve them and their constituents. So space, place, and mobility are centerpieces for all forms of social transformation.
Thank you. And I just want to add to that, as an ethnographer, I've been really concerned, and your work has really inspired me to think about place and space. I've really been concerned about the relationship between space and place and people's interactions, and particularly gender and masculinity. I remember growing up in Detroit, where, interestingly, I always felt like I had to do some gender labor to kind of reinforce my masculinity in order to, you know, fend off all of the faggot and sissy calls that I received. And it created a kind of gender work for me that I feel like I squashed my ability to be vulnerable, my ability to be accessible, my ability to be human. And given the ways in which we engage in our masculinity, and we both remember that gender is something that we do, it's not who we are, that the way that we engage in our masculinity, sometimes given the anti-Black racist violence inflicted upon us, or that we are constantly under threat to experience, how do we still, in your view, how do we still access our vulnerability? I know for me, it's been a learning process to be able to connect with other people, to be able to voice those concerns, but it's also been a struggle because I don't always know when it is safe to be vulnerable.
Yeah, I think anybody who knows the men in their lives, and not trying to say that all cisgendered males practice the same kind of masculinity, right. and also leaving space for non-cisgendered males who are also participating in the production of masculinity. But I think all people who have men in their lives know that there's a public man and there's the private one. And mm-hmm. I think what a lot of men, particularly men of color, grapple with is because of the forms of violence that exist in the public sphere, right? Homophobic violence, racist violence, that men of color and Black men in particular have to find ways to navigate that in the public sphere. And it means having to perform a certain kind of masculinity, one that is sort of tough or impenetrable or super cool, and you know, can sort of all of the insults and the sort of parade of troubles that rained upon them, you know, fall off their back. And what that does is it makes vulnerability, which is really about strength, incredibly mm-hmm. difficult. So many men have problems being vulnerable with the women in their lives, whomever they are, mothers, sisters, partners, aunts, uncles, you know, teachers, friends. But most importantly, they have the most trouble being vulnerable with the men in their lives because mm-hmm. of fear of being called gay or fear of just being rejected. And there is this correlation between how men walk in the world and the things that they are confronted with and the ways that they shield themselves or attempt to shield themselves from it. And what that does to their intimate lives, how it shapes their inability to be vulnerable. So, you know, like many other men, I also struggle to be vulnerable as well. And it is still a process. I have not conquered that mountain. It's really a lifelong struggle.
Ongoing thing. Yeah.
Ongoing thing. But it is something that, again, is a gendered phenomena that I think has an important spatial component to it.
Yeah, and I love the fact that you brought up the sort of the diversity of masculinity, and that because gender is what we do, masculinity is what we do, we can choose different kinds of masculinity that are not homophobic, that are not transphobic, that's not violent, that's not misogynist. And so, but we also have to kind of do that work, and we have to think about knowledge, we've got to talk to people, and we've got to kind of do the internal work. The last thing I wanted to ask you is your opinion about how do we use space, this notion about the man in the home or in private, if we can think about the private space of the home, and then the man outside, whether it's cisgender men or trans men. How do we negotiate those spaces and remain emotionally healthy and be present for others in our community?
We need to find ways for men to demonstrate affection and vulnerability in public. I just give a quick example. I do this with my students a lot, but you know, when people see men out in public, and you know, sort of in this case, sort of regardless of race or regardless of class, you know, there's a way in which men engage each other, right? You know, how they sit at the bar, their physical relationship to one another, and you know, men have a lot of publicly shoulder to shoulder relationships where they sit at the bar and they stare up at the screen and they're shoulder to shoulder. But we need a little bit more face-to-face engagement. And we need to, you know, move away from the screen at the bar or wherever and look at each other and do the hard work of asking, you know, how are you doing? How are you mm-hmm. feeling? And provide a space for men to do that. And also provide some space for men to demonstrate forms of public affection. And while that will not ward off white supremacy, while it will not ward off homophobia, If two to three men can find ways in public to engage and to be intimate, I think it creates, if you will, a little bubble where mm-hmm. where men can perform masculinity in ways that are counter to the often hegemonic and deeply destructive ways that men practice and engage with masculinity.
And just to add to that, tell the people, including the men in your life, that you love them.
Tell them that you love them, right? Kiss them, hold their hand, right? Yes. Right. Those are important ways of practicing masculinities mm-hmm. in public space that are nurturing, affirming, and loving.
Tell all your people you love them. Thank you, everybody. Thank you, brother. Right. Love you. Thank you for this conversation.
Thank you, brother. I love you.
Thank you. Thank you, Marlon. Thank you, Rashad, for the amazing, amazing words. So up next, we have, Up next, we have Dr. Tracy Morris. She is the Executive Director of the American Indian Policy Institute and a member of the Chickasaw Nation of Oklahoma.
Chukma, Hachi Chokmata. So Holchafoat, Alichi, Tracy Morris, and Chokachafa Holchafoat in Koni Homa. Hi y'all, I'm Dr. Tracy Morris, and I am an enrolled member of the Chickasaw Nation of Oklahoma. And I wanna take a quick second to make an acknowledgement here. The Chickasaw Nation, we were slaveholders, and our descendants are not recognized by the Chickasaw Nation, but there are families. I've actually met some descendants of I don't even know how to phrase it. At any rate, I want to make sure that I make that acknowledgement and that folks understand that tribes also held slaves. When we moved on the Trail of Tears, they were a part of our entourage. I also want to make a land acknowledgement. I appreciate that we started our day in the right way, but I also want to acknowledge that ASU sits on the ancestral homelands of those American Indian tribes that have been inhabited this land for centuries, including the Akimelotham, the Pima, and the Peeposh Maricopa peoples. So I want to start out here. You know, I'm a scholar, but this is my first real foray into academics as the executive director at AIPI. My degree is in American Indian Studies and Comparative Cultural and Literary Studies. And for me, the work I do, whether as a scholar or a leader, has been is grounded in my academics, but I've spent my career really working either for state government or community organizations and such. So first and foremost, I am a leader with that background, and I understand the things that we are talking about today, and the work I do is grounded and in what we're talking about today. But the specific work I do at this point in my life is I write in a specific voice. I write for policymakers. The work that I do, that the Institute does, is firmly centered in social justice realms. But many of you may know that Native Nations have a special policy relationship with the federal government. And I have to acknowledge that in this world, if you're speaking to policymakers between government to government in a government to government relationship, you don't use such terms as colonization, social justice, or systemic racism. Not if you want a seat at the table to make policy and affect change. I think some of you are going to criticize me about this. I expect it. I know it because I hear it from the younger generations who talk about decolonization. But as an old punk rocker, I own it. I've finally learned my lesson for me on how to make change. I use the enemy's language. You have to know it as well as them. You have to know it better than them. But if you know that language, then you can work by building collaborative relationships with other similar communities and bringing that information to bear in a way that Washington does listen. Even though they don't always listen, and a lot of times they don't listen, but occasionally we have some wins. I'm not gonna go into that, but if you're curious, look at AIPI's blog about the McGirt decision, which was the biggest win in 100 years for Indian country from the Supreme Court. So I am the executive director of the American Indian Policy Institute at ASU, and we're in the Watts College. And I seek to lead AIPI as an organization that works to create change. And I do that personally, professionally, and I hope I lead by example for my staff. But we are leading the discourse on tribally driven informed policy making. And we're the only tribal policy institute in the nation that's doing this. We do policy research and analysis And we use applied knowledge. We create partnerships with academia in Indian country. We have a stellar advisory council from the community that advises us. And we serve communities via capacity building initiatives. So I wanted to give you guys a couple of examples of the kind of work we're doing in Indian country and with tribal communities to do research that brings on the ground information to lawmakers in right now. Our area of specialty and my area of specialty historically has been the digital divide. That is my primary area of research. And it's also one of the areas that we are specialists in at AIPI. And so this is the digital divide we're all pretty aware of right now, I guess. I was shocked at the beginning of the pandemic because all of a sudden people saw it as an issue. People were worried about our communities. And I have to admit, I went through this really a strongly angry phase because it was like, really? Y'all just figured it out right now. I've been talking about this 13 years. AIP has been talking about it for the last 7. And now you're thinking it's our communities, our rural, tribal, and communities of color now we're an issue. So we know what broadband is. And we know that it's essential as a utility, although it'll never be regulated as such. And it's the underlying framework of our world, from education to healthcare, to telehealth, to energy and governance. It indeed, broadband is deemed a human right by the United Nations and your Indigenous Peoples Council. So last fall, we published and released the first, it was really the second study. I did the first study in 2009, but it's really the stronger study, and it was a tribal technology assessment. We surveyed tribal members on reservations on the state of internet on tribal lands. And we've used that widely this year in doing policy work and policy briefs, submitting comments to the federal government and such. But here's a couple stats we found that are pretty enlightening. 18% of tribal reservation residents have no internet access at home, wired or wireless, doesn't matter. 33% rely on internet service from a smartphone at home. But y'all, how do you do homework on a smartphone? And the reality is some of those connections are pretty questionable. And 31% of our respondents said that connection was spotty or that they had no connection at home. And these findings and others really, demonstrate the need for increased home high-speed broadband access on tribal lands. Of course, it sounds very clinical to say that, given the fact that that what we know is really happening now with the pandemic and access for school and all these other things. But, this is a divide that we have to cross. We have to cross this, our students aren't gonna have the same opportunities. Our kids aren't gonna have the same opportunities. And that's a whole other story. Anybody wants information, please reach out. The other area that I've been working on quite a bit lately is the issue of missing and murdered Indigenous women and girls. So in a year ago, we signed the bill in this state, House Bill 2570, to do research on violence against, on missing and murdered Indigenous women and girls in Arizona. We are one of about, I think it's 12 states that have legislation to do this study and follow up on this and such. And we are just about finished with our study. In fact, my head's all in the data right now because I've been co-writing this with a team that's led by the Watts College and Dr. Kate Fox. But this is an epidemic. We have got to address this. I'm not gonna go into these stats because I don't think I have time. I got like 2 minutes, but I'm gonna say that violence against Native women on reservation exceeds any other group in the United States. It's usually interracial or non-Natives doing that. And 55% or more than half of American Indian Alaska Natives have experienced physical violence. I could go into many of these stats, but a lot of the problem here, not all of the problem, but a lot of it is erasure. And I think our colleagues in the Black communities and other brown communities and such are going to understand that erasure is a thing and it is happening. It is not only the lack of the data, it is the misclassification of data, it is the misclassification of race, of tribe, of it's inaccurate and stereotypical media representations. It is bolstering stereotypes, it's institutional media bias and victim blaming language. this is an issue and we need to be talking about it now. So it's a lot of information. I'm going to try and wrap it back around here now, but you know, I just want to thank the organizers for asking me to participate in this event. I'm going to say that this was one of the most difficult thought process I have to go through, because when you work through an applied setting all the time and an applied lens to your work and your research, it's really hard to shift and put it into a bigger context. And so it was difficult for me, but I want you all to pay attention to one thing. On Friday afternoon, the president put out a new memo to his agencies and departments, and it was innocuously titled Training the Federal Government. The memo's far from innocuous. The president has now deemed that training at the federal government level that includes critical race theory, white and white privilege as anti-American propaganda. And furthermore, that the government will no longer, my timer, support that funding and any training is related or uses these terms. Look, we have to be part of the solution. It's going to take all of us. Colonialism and slavery are a shared heritage, but we all need to dismantle this because we all need to be a part of the solution. And I have seen solutions work. I still have hope. So seeing all you folks talk about this and the folks yesterday online, it just is overwhelming to me. So Chokmashki, thank you.
Thank you so much, Tracy, for sharing your knowledge with us today. And I wanted to just sort of echo that many folks in Arizona will be very familiar with the language that President Trump used as it applied to the ethnic studies ban in Arizona. And so that was particularly triggering when I first saw the announcement. Our next presenters are Anaya Braveboy, president of the Black African Coalition, Diane Solorio, director of advocacy for El Concilio, and Farhat Ali, the co-president of the Women's Coalition. They're going to speak about the importance of coalitions, the kind of work they do, and the importance of solidarity across coalitions, especially as ASU moves to become a more socially just campus.
Hello, thank you for that beautiful introduction. I am Anaya Braveboy, president of the BAC.
Hi, everyone. I am Farhat Ali, co-president of the Women's Coalition.
Hi, everyone. I'm Diane Solorio. I'm the director of advocacy for Concilio.
So with our discussion today, we want to focus a lot on solidarity within our coalitions as well as within ASU and how we as students and student leaders can make it so that ASU is a university that reflects a lot of our views as well as a university that is representative of the students that it is supposed to be representing.
Yeah, so pretty much the Council of Coalitions do join together with all seven coalitions that represent all underrepresented minorities and students here at ASU. And we gather to simply identify different needs that our student populations are currently lacking. This previous summer, we were able to join together after the police killings of Ahmaud Arbery and George Floyd and, you know, all the countless others, and release our statement of solidarity. And we were able to identify a series of initiatives and resources that the Black community could use during this hard time. And moving forward, you know, all the coalitions joined together to help Women's Coalition with the countless initiatives that they are working on, especially with sexual assault and everything else that has been happening here at ASU. And I believe that it's important for all of us to continue to join together just to simply have strength in numbers and really provide the execution and the, I'm lost for words. And, you know, just to simply make sure that we are standing together, standing for our students and continuing to get work done.
Yes, definitely. So Much of our work through a lot of that legislation and the Statement of Solidarity led to our partnerships with the MSC. Also, a lot of what we've been seeing on campus moving forward with the BLM committees that Anaya has been spearheading, a lot of that is tied into the intersections between our different coalitions. And I know with El Concilio, with the Black African Coalition, and with the Women's Coalition, a lot of the different proposals that we saw are things that are tied directly into our coalition and getting more representation for students on campus.
Sorry, is it working fine? Yeah, can you guys hear me? Okay, cool. Yeah, and I just wanna like echo how like important it is for us to stand together, like as members of the Council of Coalition in solidarity, but also so that we can reflect better the intersectionality within our coalitions. So for example, like solidarity is important, you know, because of course we care about the Black communities, but also like the Black communities within our own coalition. So like if we weren't like supportive of one another, we'd be doing a disservice to like the Afro Latinos or like the Afro Indigenous communities or like Black women, you know, who we also have the responsibility to represent and uplift, you know. So just wanted to add that.
Yes, there's a lot of intersectionality. As I am an Afro Latina, I'm Black and Caribbean. So I mean, I am Black, but I'm also a woman. But then, you know, I also can identify myself as a Latina. So there's a lot of intersectionality, which is why we work so well together and we understand the importance of solidarity. And we understand the importance of, you know, helping each other out with literally anything that we need. In response to, you know, President Crow releasing his 25 statement initiatives, and he committed to a series of things for Black students, the BAC did not just want to make sure that it was centered around Black students. We wanted to make sure that all minority students finally got their seat at the table, and to ensure that everyone was able to demand the resources and everything else that is not here at ASU. It's important for, you know, to say Black Lives Matter, but to also understand that all minorities here at ASU is suffering racism and, you know, other forms of discrimination. And, you know, the BAC, as well as Women's Coalition and ELCO, we've been able to just simply identify and mesh all of our things together, yet, you know, still focusing on our own coalition and ensuring that our specific students get the stuff that they need. However, again, the intersectionality has been very grand as we've been able to just simply identify different things within all of our coalitions that we all need.
Definitely. And I completely echo what both Diane and Anaya are saying in terms of the coalitions. I know that with the coalitions beginning, all seven of our coalitions became things on campus because they wanted to make sure that we had that representation that we were looking for. So in terms of representation, all of our student leaders are there to create spaces for students that don't have those spaces already. And as well as that part, most of what we were doing for Welcome Weeks and making them more inclusive this year, especially with things being online, is tying them into the different things that we want to see within ASU. So in terms of our BLM committees, in terms of our legislation and our different proposals, all of these things are tied directly into the solidarity work that we work on within a council of coalitions and as well as within our own coalitions. So specifically talking about the different legislation work and the different advocacy work that we all do within our coalitions. Anaya and Diane, can you both also touch on the different work that you've been doing personally within your own coalitions and how that's advancing representation and showcasing the different ways that we work within our coalitions to make ASU a more inclusive space for students of color and Black students?
Of course, the BAC has been really busy since the beginning of June. I don't really believe I got a summer break because we were always busy with just simply identifying the lack of resources that ASU had for its Black students. A lot of our Black students did not know about the Black African Coalition going into college. So, you know, we decided to design a tour that is for Black incoming students. And with that tour, they'll be able to know about our 31 member organizations, as well as our coalition, and know about the different Black faculty and staff and other resources that are specifically for them. There was also no scholarship that was strictly for Black, African, African-American, and Caribbean students. Therefore, we decided to create one, which has now gone live for our students to apply for. And, you know, there was also no partnerships with employers and companies to ensure that our Black people were able to get employment after graduation, or, you know, simply just having those internships, you know, just having simple relationships with employers and different professionals within the Phoenix area. Therefore, the BAC took the initiative to, you know, create a sponsorship package and increase the outreach within employers and different companies. And, you know, with and then also with our advocacy work, we did the march, even though we were told not to do it. And then, you know, President Crow released his statement saying that he has committed to a series of initiatives that are directed towards the Black community. Therefore, the BAC decided to spearhead it and create 8 committees that are specifically designed to go further and further in depth over his 25 initiatives and work close with President Crow, his office, as well as other administration to ensure that Black students' voices are heard during the implementation of all 25 initiatives.
Thank you for sharing, Anaya. But yeah, like in El Concilio, we've been trying, you know, to first and foremost support like the BAC, you know, take a part of the committees that they've created, you know, and just be like, stand as much in solidarity as we can, but also like really take the time to like reflect on our own like identity and heritage. You know, Latinidad is often a term that, you know, is successful in the erasure of like Indigenous and Black Latinos, you know, and so like how can we educate ourselves on what Latinidad means, and how can it be a more inclusive terms, and how can we as a coalition be more welcoming to like Black Latinos and Indigenous Latinos, you know, who might not feel like El Concilio is a space for them, you know? So just really trying to like reflecting on us as a coalition, how we can be more inclusive to Black and Indigenous people within our communities, and how we can work together with the BAC as well in a lot of these initiatives that they're leading. Mm-hmm.
And one that is completely, that's honestly amazing. And I also really do agree, Anaya, that I feel like a lot of the work that we've been doing, especially this summer, has fed into our school year. So honestly, if you really think about it, many of our coalition leaders, as well as different organization leaders, haven't had a summer. We've been organizing, we've been advocating, we've been doing work that has in some ways maybe gone unnoticed a bit by ASU administration, but for us, it really has created that foundation for what we've been working on in the fall and also moving towards the spring. I know specifically with the Women's Coalition, a lot of our work looks at equity and creating equitable spaces for all women and all non-binary people on campus. In years past, one of the things that we've worked on is going towards equitable healthcare, because we know that with Black and Brown women, there are disproportionate ways that we are affected by the healthcare system. So specifically looking at menstruation and the menstrual equity initiatives that we've been putting into work on campus in support of USG and also with the support of USG. This year, we're looking to expand more of those resources because we want to make sure that in a university like ASU, where we have these resources, we're putting sanitary products and sanitary items within the bathrooms that are actually helping students and not hurting them, because they are things that are actually of quality and of value. The second thing that we're also moving forward is with suffrage. With this year being 100 years since women have had the right to vote, we recognize that Black and Brown women have not had the right to vote for 100 years. And we want to make sure that we're expanding that access to voting for our vulnerable communities on campus, as well as things that are off campus for communities that don't have the opportunities to vote or may not know the resources to vote. So we want to make sure that as Women's Coalition, in partnership with other coalitions, as well as with the undergraduate student government, we're making sure that students have those access, the accessibility to be able to vote and to understand what the impact of their voting rights are. Moving forward with that, one thing you touched on, Anaya, was the creation of scholarships and making sure that we're actually representing the people that go to our university and that may not have access to scholarships. So moving forward, we definitely want to make sure that we are representing students within scholarships. We're making sure that we have funding for students who may be first generation in their family. I was reading something the other day that was talking about how in the United States, we've had universities for hundreds of years. And to think that many Black and Brown students who have lived here for a very long time and have generations of family behind them are first generation college students is baffling to think that we have not had the opportunity or the resources to be able to attain higher education. This is the first time many of us are in college, the first ones in our family to be here. And we're having to step up as leaders. We're having to step up as representatives to make sure that we're leaving that door open for students who are coming behind us. Is honestly really mind blowing to think that we're stepping into these roles, but at the same time, it's our first time even being in these positions. Also going forward with that, one of the other things that the Women's Coalition is really wanting to focus on this year with the support of other organizations, as well as with the Council of Coalitions, are activism sessions that focus on how we are moving forward with the different BLM committees, how we're moving forward with the Multicultural Solidarity Coalition and their proposals, and also how we're moving forward personally within our own coalitions to advance the advocacy that we've been doing. And the first one that we want to focus on specifically within the Women's Coalition is the ASU Police Department. How do we dismantle and disarm a police department that is being given more resources now with the proposal sent out by Michael Crow? How do we make sure that students are actually being represented in a university that will not classify itself as a sanctuary university? What is making it so difficult when students of color and Black students are crying out at the top of their lungs that they need the support, they need to be represented, and yet the coalitions are here, we're doing the best that we can, but we may not be receiving that work and the support from the administration and some of the faculty who may not even realize that we exist on campus. So the main thing that I just want to focus on is how can we have solidarity with the faculty and with students and with other organizations on campus when a lot of our work is being undermined by the administration and the things that we're trying to push forward are being pulled back and we're being told that a lot of these things can happen in a university that claims that it's inclusive and it's for all. So how can we do the best job that we can when we're new to a lot of these spaces and we don't have a lot of the resources that we need?
Absolutely. You hit it right on the nail, especially with a lot of our Black male presidents reporting that they've had to deal with racial profiling just from walking home from the library at night. And, you know, there's been a series of other things of, you know, ASUPD talking to our Black students yet having their hand on their weapon. Therefore, you know, it doesn't promote a safe campus for all students that, you know, claims to thrive on diversity and inclusivity. And with us, the BAC, having multiple conversations with ASU administration and ASUPD, we do not feel as if anything has come from those conversations. You know, the BAC has also been in a series of meetings with the city PDs that surround our campuses, yet a Tempe police officer was just suspended for holding a Black man while he was actually searching for a white suspect. So with that said, how can we continue to have these conversations? How can we continue to advocate and push for policy change when people are undermining us and not listening to us? And as we represent all minority students here at ASU, we know what needs to happen. We know the change that needs to be done, yet, you know, ASU administration has just been simply taking what we say as suggestions and, you know, believing that they're creating new policy and creating new forms of, what is the word? You know, they're just creating new things that are actually not needed at ASU. For Michael Crow, his 25th initiative was to create a new racial sensitivity training for ASUPD. And I believe they created a new training back in 2018, yet nothing happened. So are we going to be brought to the table for the new training? Will we be able to provide our own input, or will they be able to actually understand what we're trying to say and disarm and dismantle ASUPD and simply provide us with the resources and programming that we actually need from this campus for our minority students?
Yeah, and just to kind of echo off that, also like USG, you know, has also been working with us on disarming and defunding ASUPD. I know they just passed a resolution, I think it was last week, that was heavily written by the BAC as well. And it just goes to show how like ASU just kind of takes what we as students think, even though they like we pay tuition and stuff like that. It's just like a suggestion, you know, because the day after the resolution was passed, you know, they just went ahead and just said, oh no, actually, police officers will not have bachelor's degrees, you know, when it's something that we never really asked for, nor do we want. I think someone mentioned it earlier that, you know, schools of police officers are statistically proven to be like more dangerous. And like ASU is a school, you know, that includes ASU. So like, how can we continue pushing for like ASUPD? How can we continue putting pressure on the university to defund this if it's not seeming to listen? But I think this is one of the ways in which we do that, you know, a scholar strike in which we have support from like the staff and the community. I think that's a good start. That's a good place to start.
Yeah, completely, Diane. I think that that really ties in a lot of like what we mean when we're talking about how can we actually have solidarity with ASU when a lot of our concerns aren't actually being addressed. And I know we only have a few minutes left, so I want us to like focus a little bit on like education and implementing different support structures within our community and within ASU, and what kind of like structural change we actually want to see at ASU through our coalition work and through the support of the administration.
I'm sorry, can you repeat the last part of your question?
Yeah, so a little bit about how we can actually implement structural change within the university with the support of our administration.
Of course, so I know the BAC can speak on this, especially when we created the Black Lives Matter committees in response to President Crow's 25 initiatives. We went directly to the people that will be in charge of the implementation, which is the Office of Inclusion and Community Engagement. And we spoke to the provost and vice provost. And from those conversations, they simply encouraged us to continue with the committees, and they will be there in most of the committee meetings to simply, you know, provide input and to hear what our students are saying and what we are finding and what we're researching. At the end of the semester, we will be presenting all of our findings and information in one humongous policy brief and giving it directly to administration, which is again the vice provost and provost who are in charge of implementing all 25 initiatives. So hopefully by the end of the semester, we'll be able to better identify exactly what's left to do that the BAC and our wonderful coalitions want going into the following years. With all the leaders that are in the coalitions right now, I believe we have set the ground running, and you know, we're off to an amazing start, and I believe this is going to be the year that we actually get the change that we're hopefully looking for. We have some strong-minded and intelligent leaders that know what they're doing, and you know, I believe administration honestly isn't used to it, especially in the conversations that we've had. You know, I've seen their faces. They're like, wow. They're amazed with everything that we always say, the information that we're able to provide, you know, because we never go into a meeting blindsided. We've done our research. We have the statistics. We have the evidence. And we're like, okay, if you guys have done this for years and you see nothing has changed, why would you continue to do it? And from there, you know, they've been able to invite us to the table and invite us to their different committees. And I've seen the systematic change, especially within the W.P. Carey School of Business. So we're really hoping going into by fall 21, we should have everything that we're aiming for.
Yeah.
And just to add on something else, I think something I would like to see from the university, or I think most of the coalitions would like to see from the university, is just, you know, the dismantling of like harmful organizations. You know, there's a few organizations on campus that just promote like a culture of violence, you know, and it's really disheartening to see ASU just kind of watch and like do nothing when, like, you know, we're supposed to be about inclusivity and stuff, but we have like an organization that's like raising funds for like a murder. So it's just kind of like, that's something else I would like to like see from the university.
And I just want to thank you both. I honestly think that any discussion we have as coalition leaders is honestly amazing. And I love seeing all the work that you're both doing within your own coalitions. But I know we have to end it off now. So I just want to end off with, if you know any women, especially women of color and Black women in leadership positions, make sure that you're thanking them for the jobs that they're doing and the efforts that they're putting forward. And remember that these spaces are open for you too. And once you make it there, hold the door open for those that are coming after you. Thank you all so much.
Thank you.
Thank you.
No justice, no peace. No justice, no peace. No justice, no peace. No justice, no peace. No justice, no peace.
How do we cope when we don't love each other? times, all the time. Destruction of minds, bodies, and human rights. Stripped of bloodlines, whipped and confined. This is the American pride. It's justifying a genocide, romanticizing the theft and bloodshed that made America the land of the free. To take a black life, land of the free, to bring a gun to a peaceful fight for civil rights. You are desensitized to pulling triggers on innocent lives because that's how we got here in the first place.
I'm Karen Kuo, Associate Professor and Lead Faculty in the Asian Pacific American Studies in the School of Social Transformation.
Hi, I'm Michelle Vlahoulis. I'm Faculty Lead in Women and Gender Studies. We'd like to thank all of our sponsors that helped with this event, School of Social Transformation, the School of Historical, Philosophical, and Religious Studies, the Faculty Women of Color Caucus, School of Transborder Studies, Hugh Downs School of Human Communication, the School of Social Work, Watts College of Public Service and Community Solutions, the Institute for Humanities Research, the American Indian Policy Institute, African and African American Faculty and Staff Association, and the Center for Indian Education. So thank you.
We would also like to thank all the faculty, staff, and students that helped make the teach-in possible. We must move beyond the teach-in to collaborate, coalition build, agitate, and continue to educate ourselves and others. Many of us will continue on that path by joining clubs and organizations, community groups in Arizona, and even teaching and taking classes in the 11 schools who are co-sponsors of this event. Or attending events. So there is an event coming up through the School of Historical, Philosophical, and Religious Studies on policing, protest, and social movements in the past and present of the United States. This will take place on September 25th from 3 to 4:30 via Zoom. For more information, this will be listed on our resource list for the teach-in, or you can email Catherine Bynum and Shippers. I leave you with Frantz Fanon, psychiatrist, activist, and author of Black Skin, White Mask, who explains that in the quote, refusal to accept the present as definitive, why does one revolt? Is it because, quite simply, it was becoming impossible to breathe? I hope that the teaching has given collectively our breath to continue that we so desperately believe in and need. Please join us now for the interactive discussion portion of the teach-in over at Zoom. It's all lowercase, no spaces, ASU Teach-In 2020. Thank you, everyone.